Oh, thank you, Michele, for the introduction, and thank you to you and to Luca for the invitation. It's a real pleasure to be back, and really a pity not to be really back. But these days is as far as we can go. So yes, I want to talk about this topic of massive stellar neutrinos in single and double beta decays, and it's something I was working on in these two works mainly. So one that I did when I was still in Paris, working with Asma Bada and Álvaro Hernández Cabezudo, that was in Karlsruhe at that time. And a newer one that I work when I was already here in Munich with Alejandro Ibarra, that I know you know him very well. And also two other people from the Gerda collaboration. And that were Matteo Agostini and Elisabetta Bosio. So the motivation to pack these two groups, these two papers together, were that they share the same idea, that the same starting point, I will say, that was neutrino oscillations. So they are the only experimental proof that we have at the laboratory level, that the standard model needs to be extended if at least people studying G minus two of the muon still allow me to say that. And yeah, we know that because neutrino oscillations, neutrinos have masses that are something that are not included in the standard model. And using neutrino oscillation, actually, we know many things about these neutrino masses and mixing. So we know the values of the three mixings. We know the mass differences, or at least the absolute value of these mass differences. There are other things like the mass ordering or the Dirac CP phase that we still don't know, but we are hoping to learn about them in future neutrino oscillation experiments. And there are some other things that we cannot really learn about them using neutrino oscillations. This, like the absolute mass scale of neutrinos and the nature of neutrinos, or whether they are Dirac or Majorana. And our best chances to prove this is studying other kind of experiments that are related to single and double beta decays. So what we want to do is focus in these two kind of experiments, but not to explore the three light neutrinos that we are already exploring in neutrino oscillations, but to do some kind of new physics there. And the new physics that we will choose will be the system of stellar neutrinos. And let me tell you why. It's very personal, but I like stellar neutrinos basically because when I look at their CV, it's just amazing because they have been proven like to be very useful in models explaining neutrino masses, but they have many other skills if you want, because they can also be involved in explanations of oscillation anomalies, providing a dark matter candidate, or playing an important role in biogenesis. So maybe this is why they are a key ingredient in many times when we start cooking all these BSM models. Okay, so this is why I like, and this is why we focus on them. So the outline of this talk, like in a very sketchy way, will be basically starting reviewing the experimental status for single and double beta decays. Then we will discuss a bit about stellar neutrinos, how to look for them, and especially focus on their role in single beta decay and neutrinoless double beta decays. And finally, I will present a new way of directly searching how directly search for these stellar neutrinos in the process of two neutrino to beta decay. Okay, so let me start from the beginning, and in this case I really mean the beginning, because talking about single beta decays is talking about the origin of the neutrinos, or at least our knowledge about neutrinos. So there are several nucleus, so let me consider tritium, for instance, as main example that we will focus in on many times out of this talk. So tritium can decay to helium, emitting a beta decay, so a beta particle, so emitting an electron. And if we compute the mass differences, we realize that this electron can have energy up to 18.6 keV. So indeed, if that was everything that was happening in this process, those electrons will always have the energy of 18.6 keV. But we know from experiment that this is not the case. So when we plot the energy distribution of this electron, we see a continuous spectrum. And that was telling us that there was something else there carrying on the missing energy, that was the neutrino or the antineutrino in this case. But that is not everything that we can learn from these single beta decay experiments, because the idea of this endpoint of 18.6 keV is basically computed assuming that neutrinos are massless. So if neutrinos are actually massive, as we know, this endpoint will be smaller because it will be shifted by an amount equal to the mass of the neutrino. So if we manage our experiment to focus really in this regime very close to the endpoint and measure it very, very precisely, we should be able to see the shift and therefore to infer the mass, the absolute mass of the neutrinos. Okay, it's not exactly that simple because there are actually three neutrinos, as we know. So what we measure is a combination of the three, is this effective beta antineutrino mass that is basically an average weighted by the PMNS matrix element of the neutrinos, but in the end, this combined with the mass difference will give us everything that we need to know about neutrino masses. So this idea, precisely in tritium, has been used for a long time already. At the beginning of this century, we had this result from Mainz and Troisk that set an upper limit of about 2 electron volt. And we were waiting for Katrin, for the Katrin experiment to improve this measurement. We were waiting for it for a very long, long time. It finally came. So 2 years ago already, they finally switched on this big machine that they have, and they were able to release some data, and they improve the upper limit from this 2 electron volt to 1.1 electron volt. And although maybe this improvement doesn't seem so spectacular at the beginning, it really is, because they were able to improve this measurement using just 5 days of effective data taking. So yes, with these 5 days, they were improving both the statistical and systematical errors. So these were very good news, and we were looking forward to see how far they can improve this limit, or even better, if they can actually measure the value of the neutrino masses. And indeed, last 2 weeks ago, there was an announcement in a couple of conferences from Katrin that they were releasing new data, and they were improving a bit this bound, this upper bound, from 1.1 to 0.9 electron volts. So it was for the first time going down the electron volt scale. And yeah, I have to admit that these results are so new that the only source of that I found for this reference was Twitter, because this is where I found it. I was looking for the publication that I was not able to see. So if you are able to find, or I guess they will be waiting for the last refinement to publish it. So we will need to stay tuned and see the details of their analysis. So they will keep going for a few years more, and the goal they have is to reach the 0.1 electron volt limit for this effective mass. So this limit, it will be very impressive, because it will be just a factor of 2 better to compare to the limit that you can really have working with tritium with molecular tritium as they do, because from the systematics of molecular tritium, you cannot go below 1.1 electron volt. So Catherine aims to go to 0.2, sorry, I said it wrong. And so in order to go a bit farther and especially trying to cover all the mass ranges possible for the inverted ordering, we need to break this molecular tritium and we need to go to atomic tritium. That is really, really challenging, as you can imagine, but there is a project called Project 8 that aims to do it. So hopefully they will manage, and for sure we know that the inverted ordering will not escape from these experiments. Okay, so from the other hand, we want to focus on the double beta decay, in particular in the neutrino-less double beta decay. So double beta decay is, as the name is saying, when two beta decays happen at the same time. So in this case, we have two electrons and two neutrinos, and if we plot the energy spectrum of the sum of the energies of the two electrons, what we expect is something continuous with an endpoint that roughly is in the few MeV, depending on the nuclei, but it's always of the order. And the point is that if neutrinos are Majorana, we can take these two neutrinos that were emitted and we can close the line in such a way that it becomes an internal line, and everything that is emitted is basically these two electrons. And because there is nothing else emitted there, it's happening the other way around, was happening in the single beta decay. The energy is picked exactly at the end point of this process. So basically the two electrons carry all the release energy as expected. So because the neutrinos are an internal line now, we have to sum over all possibilities there, and the sum will be a coherent sum, which means that here, if you want the formula, or if you want, all this amplitude will be proportional to this effective combination, this effective mass for double beta decays. And as I was saying, because it is a coherent sum, the absolute value is outside, meaning that we will be sensitive to the mixings, to the phases of the mixing. So we will be sensitive in this case to the CP phases related to neutrinos. Okay, so there are many, many experiments trying to search for these experiments, for this decay, sorry, and many more that are about to come. Right now, we have several experiments working with several isotopes that have imposed a strong lower limits on the decay lifetimes of these neutrino-less double beta decay processes. Then we can convert these lower limits on the half times to upper limits in this effective mass combination. And as you can see, each of them is given within a range. And the origin of the range is because in this translation, we have to involve the nuclear matrix elements that are really difficult to compute. People are doing great, but still we have some relatively big uncertainties there. So this is why, translated to this effective mass, we have a range. But this is how we can compare the different isotopes. And right now, Kamlan-Sen, working with xenon, gives us the strongest constraint. And in the future, things look really promising because there are many experiments planned that will run, and some of them will, the ones that will be leading the future of neutrino-less double beta decay, meaning Legend 1000 working with germanium, Nexo working with xenon, and Cupid working with molybdenum. They plan to cover all the possibilities for the inverted ordering. So assuming that we have this scenario with these three light neutrinos, these experiments should be able to tell us whether the inverted ordering is there if neutrinos, of course, are Majorana. So putting the two observables that we discussed together, we have this standard picture when we assume that we have only three neutrinos following the neutrino oscillations data, so basically the PMNS, and assuming that they are Majorana. So what we have is these two bands that are prediction assuming normal ordering and inverted ordering of the effective mass entering the neutrino less double beta decay against the mass of the lightest neutrino. So the width of these bands is basically because we don't know the CP phases of the involved entering the PMNS. So we can vary them and we have these kind of bands. So what I like from this plot is that we can see very clearly the complementarity of the two observables that we were discussing, because the searches at the endpoint in this single beta decays are closing this parameter space from right to left, whereas a neutrinoless double beta decay searches are closing this parameter space from top to bottom. So you see how that between the two, they are basically covering all possibilities, and maybe they will find something positive, and if not, they will be able, for instance, to exclude all the inverted ordering, assuming this hypothesis of three neutrinos. Okay, so that is from the experimental point of view about neutrino masses, but what does theory say? Because we need a theory that we know is not the standard model, but we need a theory that explains why, so how these neutrinos have got this mass and why these masses are much smaller than the other masses that we have for the rest of the fermions. So from the effecting point of view, the answer could be actually really simple, because if we take the standard model and we include a tower of effective higher dimensional operators, we can have this dimension 5, dimension 6, and so on. But it's funny that there is only one dimension 5 operator, as you will know very well, which is the Weinberg operator. And the prediction of this operator is precisely that neutrinos have acquired Majorana masses. So it seems funny, at least to me, that, you know, from the effective point of view, the first deviation from the standard model that you expect to see are precisely neutrino masses. And this is from the first place where we have seen, at least in a laboratory, that we have something new that is not included in the standard model. So it seems natural. Unfortunately, there are many, many dimension six operators, so we cannot guess which one will be the observable that is coming next. There are many possibilities, but okay, right now we can focus in this dimension five and follow with neutrino masses. So if we open this dimension five operator, we know that there are only three ways of opening it at the tree level, which defines the three types of CISO models. And there are other possibilities at one loop, and there are of course many, many of them. But something that all these kind of models, or not all, but many of them have in common, is the inclusion of sterile neutrinos. So these sterile neutrinos could be also called right-handed neutrinos, heavy neutrinos, whatever you want to call it. To me, what they have in common is that they are all standard model singlets, and they talk to the standard model only via the mixing to the active neutrinos. Okay, so when we talk about sterile neutrinos here, we will be talking about that. And since there are many models predicting the system of these neutrinos, which different properties and relation between their masses and couplings, usually it's taken another path to explore them, especially at experiments, which is maybe a simpler bottom-up approach, which is basically assuming that the three neutrinos that we know, they already have their masses. We don't know how they got it, but they already have it. And to those masses, we will add a new one. So we'll add a fourth mass that will be the mass of our sterile neutrino. And that will be a free parameter that we have no idea where it is. In the same manner, we will extend the PMNS from being a 3x3 matrix to be a 4x4 matrix, unitary, of course. And we will extend it with this row. This row will contain the mixings of this neutrino to each of the flavors. Okay, and basically these mixings which will control will be the size or the strength of the charge current interactions, which is with each of the charge lepton flavors. So this bottom-up approach is usually the one taken by experimentalists to show their limits. And here we have a summary of them. They are not the most updated one in this reference, but things didn't change that much. But what I like from this plot is that it shows in a clean way a huge mass range for this mass of the steriles. And we can see, for example, for the electron and muon mixing, how, depending on the mass, different experiments enter to prove that mass hypothesis. Okay, so if they are light, we can have these single beta decay experiments. If they are heavier, they can be produced effectively in meson decays. If they are ever heavier, we can go to high energy colliders or prove them with electroweak precision observables, lepton universality. And if they are even heavier, we can still probe them indirectly with processes like lepton flavor violation. Okay, so there are many of them, but I would like to start with this line, which is that when we talk about the mixing to electrons, if we assume that neutrinos are Majorana, so the sterile neutrinos are Majorana, they will also contribute to a neutrino-less double beta decay process. So we get this kind of bound, but let me discuss it a bit further. So we have the same diagram we were having before, where this line of Majorana neutrinos was going as internal line. If we have now extended our model to include more steriles, we'll have the same diagrams with the only difference that we will need to add this to all possible neutrinos, to all possible Majorana neutrinos. So in general, it will have this shape with this four factor is dependent on this Q that is the transfer momenta between the two nuclei, which is typically of the order of 100 MeV. So that means that this is much larger than the mass of the three active neutrinos that we know, so we can neglect them. So for the three light neutrinos, we have the same expression we were showing before. But if we have a fourth neutrino, since we don't know the mass, we have to keep this Q square dependence. Okay, so what we usually do is assume that this contribution for the fourth neutrino is much larger than the contribution from the three active ones. So if we neglect it and we impose that the contribution of the fourth neutrino to be smaller than the upper limits or from neutrino less double beta decays, we get basically this shape that is there in green. So this is clear how we do it. However, I wanted to point it out now that in doing this, we are forgetting about any possible interference between these two terms. Remember that we are doing a coherent addition of the two, so phases may play a role, and maybe things are not so simple as taking only one of these independently. But I will come back to this later. Before that, let's focus on the other observables, which are the single beta decays, but now use them to search for sterile neutrinos. So how can we do it? So the idea is very, very simple. So we have the single beta decay that we were having, we were discussing before. And now, if there are some sterile neutrinos which mix to the electron and their masses are available, or their masses are within the phase space allowed this decay, we can basically replace some of these active neutrinos by sterile neutrinos. So we'll have the same process, but a sterile neutrino will be emitted. What will be the difference? Now, the neutrino will not be almost massless, but will have a relatively large mass. So the endpoint of this spectrum will be shifted, and will be shifted again by an amount equal to the mass of the sterile neutrino. Okay, so we will have something like this line down here, which the endpoint is shifted by a macroscopically large quantity. Of course, the neutrino will be still invisible, so we will only see the electrons, and we cannot distinguish which electrons were emitted together with sterile neutrino and which ones were emitted together with the light neutrinos. So what we will have in total will be an incoherent sum of the two spectrum, which will be this red solid line here. And if you see where the endpoint of the sterile neutrino spectrum ends or takes place, we'll have a distortion of the spectra. This distortion, which is called a kink, will be a clear manifestation that something new is going there, some new massive particle was emitted there. So from the position of the kink, we will infer the mass. From the height, so to speak, or the strength of the kink, we can infer the mixing of the neutrino. So this has been used, for instance, by Minsk and Troinsk to search for few key B100 of EB neutrinos. But our interest will be again looking at Katrin. So Katrin, and especially the feature upgrade to Tristan, aims to measure the full spectrum of this single beta decay of tritium and try to search for kinks. And because they will have huge amount of statistics, they expect to be sensitive in this mass from 1 to 18 keV for the sterile neutrino masses, and be able to probe mixings between 10 to the minus 6 and 10 to the minus 8. So this is a huge improvement from the limits that we have right now at the level of 10 to the minus 3. Again, from the laboratory limits that we have right now. Okay. So now, imagine that we open the archive one day in, say, 4 or 5 years, and we find this kind of entry. So this Katrin Tristan experiment, they actually observe something. They observe a kink, and you know they really observe it with a lot of statistics. So from that kink, they infer the value of the mass that was few keV, and the value of the mixing that was up to 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 8. Okay, so if that was the case, what will be the implication of such a discovery? So will that imply a new neutrino? So from one side, we'll have a huge impact in cosmology and astrophysics, because the bounds that you can impose in this parameter space from astrophysics, especially from X-rays, are stronger than the sensitivities that Katrin aims to reach. But still, if we separate for a moment astrophysics and cosmology from laboratory experiments, what can we learn? And what will be the implications from this kind of neutrinos to other laboratory experiments? And in particular, will it be possible that this new neutrino is also a Majorana neutrino? Because if that is so, we will be having a new KeV Majorana neutrino that could have an impact in this picture that we were showing for this standard scenario of having only 3 light neutrinos. Okay, because if we start adding a fourth KeV neutrino, we can see So the difference between these three plots is that we are playing with this quantity, mass times the mixing square. So remember that a kink observation will provide input independently in mass and mixing. However, regarding the effective mass for neutrino less double beta decay, basically this combination is everything that matters for a KB neutrino. So, sorry. If we start increasing the size of this combination all the time within the reach of Catherine, we see that the plot that we were having without the fourth neutrino is getting more and more distorted. And it may happen some funny things like this inverted ordering that was suffering from no cancellation. At some point, it starts to suffer also from cancellation, meaning that they will even the inverted ordering, because of the effect of this additional neutrino, may escape the detection from future experiments. Okay, so let me twist a bit this plot. So it's the same idea. In the vertical axis, we still have the effective mass for neutrino less double beta decay. But now on the horizontal axis, what we have is this combination of my mass time mixing to the electron square of the stray neutrino. So the contribution that stray neutrino is adding to the effective Majorana mass of effective neutrino less double beta decay mass. Okay, and we can see that again, for normal ordering and inverted ordering, things may change quite a lot, and we can induce cancellation for both cases. And roughly speaking, a Catherine will be sensitive to KB neutrinos living on the right of this line. So that will mean that if we don't see any signal in neutrino less double beta decay from invert, and we want to save the inverted ordering by adding a KB steric neutrino, we can always do that. However, that neutrino must be seen by Catherine. Okay, so this is the game that we can play between the two observables. So similar than before, we are having a complementarity between the two. So as before, neutrino less double beta decay is closing this parameter space from top to bottom. Now the kink searches in single beta decay will be closing this parameter space from right to left. And this plot has been done assuming that the lightest neutrino mass is zero. So if you have a bit of imagination, you can imagine a third axis going from the screen towards you, where the lightest neutrino mass is increasing. So this endpoint searches in single beta decays will be additionally closing this parameter space from us to the screen. So you see in the end, we have the complementarity between the three closing the full parameter space. So that's very nice, but it's true that it's assuming only one neutrino. We know that in order, for instance, the type 1 CISO to work, we need at least two neutrinos. So things don't change much if all these neutrinos are light, meaning lighter than this 100 MeV scale. This plot will remain the same. The only difference is that here we will need to replace this quantity by the sum over all the new light stray neutrinos. But still, the idea of possible cancellations is still there. And now, maybe some of you are thinking, okay, yeah, sure, you can tune all these parameters of the stray neutrinos and cancel the contribution from the active neutrinos and save and basically cancel any possibility of seeing them in neutrino less double beta decay. But this is fine tuning them a lot. So how likely are these cancellations to happen? And it happens that is something not that crazy. I would say even quite the opposite, because if we take the simplest model with stellar neutrinos, so I would say the type 1 CISO. It happens that it was shown by Matthias and collaborators in that paper that if all the neutrinos are lighter than this 100 MeV, this cancellation happens automatically. And it is something actually quite easy to show. It just needs to work a bit the relations of matricial relations when we diagonalize the mass matrix of the type 1 CISO model. So you know you have this kind of standard matrix where we have Dirac masses of the diagonal, a Majorana mass for the heavy neutrinos as a zero for the Majorana mass of the active neutrinos, for the left-handed neutrinos, sorry. And this will be diagonalized to obtain the physical neutrino masses by some matrix U. But if we write the inverse diagonalization relation and we take the EE entry, so the 1-1, we can write it like this. So basically the mass, the physical masses times the mixings to the electron square. And because this is the 1-1 entry of this matrix, this is zero from cage invariance. Okay, so on the other hand, we have this effective mass governing the neutrino-less double beta decay. And we have said that we have to sum over all possible neutrinos. We have in principle this dependence in Q squared, but if we assume that all neutrinos are lighter than this one, we can neglect this term here, the Q squared, go away. And when we end up, it's basically this quantity that is the same as this line from diagonalization. So that means that the leading order is canceled basically because this diagonalization relation. So if you want, we have kind of a Jim separation. So in terms of the previous plot, what we are saying is that type 1 CISO with all possible neutrinos being lighter than 100 MeV, they naturally live in this cancellation area. So you see, it's something not that crazy in the end. And actually, we can use these kind of relations to increase the predictivity and to play a bit between the two observables even further. So in order to illustrate how we can learn things combining the two observables, let me take the simplest type 1 CISO, meaning when we add only two right-handed neutrinos. And let me assume, just for fun, that one of these neutrinos, say neutrino 4, will be in the KB regime and with a mixing that is accessible at Katrin. And let's assume that the mass of the fifth neutrino is a free parameter. So just doing a bit of algebra, we can write the total effective mass for neutrino-less double beta decay as this quantity, where we have this contribution of the three light neutrinos plus the KB neutrino, which is something basically the same thing that we were discussing. We were assuming that there was a fourth neutrino free from any relation, so totally model independent. And that will be corrected by this factor that depends on the mass of the fifth neutrino. So this is an approximation, but we check numerically that the points follow this approximation. So here we see a plot for the normal ordering, inverted ordering on the right. We have the mass of the fifth neutrino free in the horizontal axis and the prediction for the effective mass on the vertical axis. So here, the difference between blue and green points is that blue are allowed by every experimental laboratory constraint. Green, they are excluded by something. And you see that the shape the bulk shape of this is following this pattern. But now, if we assume that Catherine is actually seeing this fourth neutrino, we can now play the game of what could Catherine say about this fourth neutrino and what will be the implication for neutrinoless double beta decay. So imagine now that Catherine sees the fourth neutrino in such a way that the combination of mass times mixing square is in this regime where there is a possibility of having a cancellation for formal ordering. So that means that we don't actually learn much about the fifth neutrino, because normal, if there is no positive signal, of course, in neutrinoless double beta decay. But there is no possible cancellation between the fourth lightest neutrinos in neutrinoless double beta decay. So again, if we don't see anything in neutrinoless double beta decay and we want to save it adding a fifth neutrino, that will imply that this fifth neutrino will be light. So we are fitting in it to have a mass that is in the reach of many other experiments. Okay, so we have a motivation to look for it to save this model, if you want, if we don't see neutrinoless double beta decay after seeing a kink. The same, but the opposite will happen if it happened to be in the cancellation of the inverter ordering, and if we are in some other random place. That means that from the point of view of four neutrinos, we will expect to see it in neutrinoless double beta decay. If we don't see it, that will imply that the fifth neutrino is light. And having it light, it could be very nice, as I said, because we expect it to see it somewhere else. And that somewhere else, why not, could be maybe the Catherine experiment itself. If it happens that this a neutrino is also in the KV, it may happen that we see not one, but two kinks in this beta spectrum. And even funnier, if these two kinks are so close that, you know, the difference is almost smaller than the mass, but still we can resolve the kink and see that there are actually two. We can even point towards other kind of CISO models that they are driven by some symmetries that predict that these neutrinos will be very degenerate, usually invoking a lepton number conservation and symmetries like that. Okay, so that was basically the idea of how it was maybe the simplest possible example was having a type 1 CISO with two right-handed neutrinos, but still I think it was illustrative to show how we can combine the two single and neutrinoless double beta decay experiments to learn a bit, not about only the system of the neutrinos, but also try to infer what will be the model that is behind these signals and behind neutrino mass generation. Okay,
thank you very much.
So that was only the first part. I have a second part, which will be shorter, and that will be covering double beta decays, but this time it will be a new way of searching the stellar neutrinos directly in the two neutrino double beta decay processes. So that was an idea that we proposed here, and I will be using basically what we found, but I wanted to point out also to this other paper that came out, appeared on the archive basically when we were finishing our draft. So there were two works that were done independently and in parallel, and more or less we were proposing the same kind of idea and finding quite compatible results. So if you can have another look to that one as well. So what was our motivation? If we go back to this plot where we were having the mass and the mixing, the bounds on the mixing to the electron. I don't know about you, but if I look here in this regime, I see a gap. meaning that the bounds here seem for some reason weaker than the bounds that are surrounding them. And in order to understand them better, we can open that all those bounds that are entering this area. So this is the same plot from another reference. And we see that in this area, the bounds are coming actually from King searches in beta decays. And these nuclei that were decaying were sulfur, fluor. And the point of this is that the bounds are something like 30 years old. So I don't know why in 30 years no one was able to improve these bounds. And which is even more worrisome is that if we look at future experiments, we see that Catherine, Tristan, they are coming to improve the KEB regime. There are many, many experiments to improve the 100th MeV few KEB mass regime, but there is nothing planned to improve this area around 1 MeV masses. So we wanted to try to add something there. And we realized that, as we were saying at some point, that the endpoint of the neutrino-less double beta decay processes was precisely few MeV. So what happens if we borrow this idea of kink searches in single beta decay and we apply that to two neutrino double beta decay? So the idea will be the same. If kinematically allowed, we can replace one of these active neutrinos by an sterile one. Then the full process will be an incoherent superposition of three channels. So we have two light neutrinos, one light, one heavy, and two heavy neutrinos. But it's true that this channel with two heavy, with two steriles, will be suppressed by higher order of higher powers of this mixing, which is something small. So in principle, we can neglect this double production and focus only in this single production. And when we plot the spectrum, we'll have something similar on before. We'll have the spectrum of emitting one sterile that will be shifted with an endpoint that will be shifted by an amount equal to the mass of the sterile neutrino. The total spectrum will be the solid line that will be a superposition of the two. The difference now is that if we look at this area where the two spectrum merge, this merging is smooth. There is no kink. So if you want, the signal will not be that spectacular as in a single beta decay spectrum, but still the spectral shape with and without the sterile will be different. So one can basically take the data, fit the two spectra and see which one works better. So this is what we did. And we did it for three different isotopes, thinking that this will be the ones leading the field in the future. And we fit the spectrum. So here we can see how the sensitivity to the mixing square increases as the exposure of the experiment increases. Okay, so the main background of our signal of one sterile and one active neutrino will be the standard model background of having two steriles together with the two beta particles. There will be a small contamination of other backgrounds, but still we have seen that if you add a bit more of it, the results that don't change dramatically. What it really matters here are the systematics. So the difference between red and blue line are whether the systematics are switched on or off. So red lines are without systematics, so basically they scale naively as one will expect to scale the statistical errors. The blue ones are the results after our systematics that we did this analysis using this shape factor. But in this plot, what we assume is that the systematics, in this case for germanium, were those that are right now at the level of Gerda. Okay, so if we take the systematics that Gerda has and we basically assume that Leyen 200 and Leyen 1000 will not improve the systematics, we see that they will improve a bit, but not that much. Of course, we expect that new experiments will be able to improve a bit the systematics. So the real results should be something, I guess, in between the blue and red lines. So this will be for a mass of 500. If we put for different masses, this is what we got. So again, mass versus mixing to the electron. In gray, we have the current bound. So all these old single beta decays that we were showing at the beginning. For the difference between the upper and lower part of these bands are these of having the systematic offs. So the most optimistic case where we have only statistics, and the systematic on, that will be the most pessimistic case where the systematics have not been improved with respect to current experiments. So if we look at current results, this will be what we get from the measurement of the double beta spectrum that had been published. So the sensitivities that we got, I mean, they are not that far from current bounds, but they will be excluded. Nevertheless, in the future, things may change, because you see, for future, especially for Cupid using molybdenum, they have huge chances to improve current bounds, again, assuming that they can control the systematics. So maybe this line of purely statistics will be too optimistic, but saying that a new experiment will improve the systematics is not something that crazy. So I expect to have some results, something in between, which will improve the bounds that we have right now. Okay, so just to compare what we had between these two kind of searches, because they were very similar. So we have spectral distortions in both single beta decays and double beta decays. It's true that there are no kinks in double beta decay, but still the distortions are there and we can look for them. So both processes will have high statistics, but it's true, and here is the key point, single beta decays is the right way of searching for this kind of mass ranges. And why I say so? Because double beta decays, two neutrino double beta decays, are among the rarest processes that we have ever seen. So even if we are talking about collecting high statistics with these processes, it will always be lower than any amount of statistics that you can collect taking a single beta decay and running the experiment by just a month or two. What is the problem? That there are no future plans for single beta decays exploring this mass range. So if anybody wants to do it, it's more than welcome. In the meantime, we can basically take profit of all the effort that we will do to explore double beta decay, not maybe looking for neutrinos, but because we want to, not looking for sterilized, but we want to look for neutrino-less double beta decay and Majorana neutrinos. But once we do it, yes, for free, we can get all this data that we can use to explore sterile neutrinos. So even if it will not be the most optimal place, it will be, if you want, the cheapest one, because it is coming for free. And the last thing I wanted to say very, very quickly is that something new that can add double beta decay experiments is the possibility of producing not one, but two exotic new particles. Okay, and this is basically because we have seen at the beginning that in principle, when you can produce one neutrino, you may also produce two neutrinos, you have phase space. The problem is that the single production will always be dominant. But imagine you have some other kind of exotic model where single production is actually excluded. Say, because you have some kind of set to symmetry or something like that. So if that is so, double production will be the only way of proving it. And actually that will imply that all the bounds that we were seeing from single beta decay will not apply here. Okay, that is very nice, but you may say, okay, you are cheating. Because if you have some symmetry that is forbidding this process to happen, this triagram of the right won't also happen. You are completely right. So what I had in mind was something, some kind of more like an effective vertex. And in that sense, there are many ways of having this effective versus a vertex. So for concreteness, we took one. So we took a new particle that we call chi to distinguish from the n before. And this chi will be, if you want, charge under this kind of set to symmetry. So you have to produce it always in pair. And we added an effective vertex affecting interaction of two chi and two neutrinos. So we can produce them in this kind of diagrams. Okay, so the idea will be the same as before. We will have an incoherent addition of two spectra, one of them with a shifted endpoint. We can compute the decay rate for this exotic process, and it happens that this particular case is connected to the decay width of producing two stray neutrinos in the model that we're working with at the beginning. The difference will be that it will be related using these neutrinoless double beta decay nuclear matrix elements. So that will induce an additional source of uncertainty. So if you want, it won't be as clean as before, but still we can do something. And this is what we did. And this is the sensitivities we got for masses and effective coupling planes. And here we see with the same uncertainty bands as before. And here, okay, these are sensitivities we got. I have to admit that they were not impressive. Why I'm saying so? Because we are assuming an effective vertex in a process where there is a transfer of energy, typically of 100 MeV. So here we have 100 MeV square, inverse minus two, if you want. So everything that is above this 10 to the minus 4 is dangerous to understand it from the point of view of the effective theory. So it's well not defined. Still, that is only a problem of our way of interpreting the bounds. So maybe it's also a problem of the particular way we chose to open this effective vertex was not the smartest one. But still, experimentally, there is nothing wrong. It's always useful to search for these distortions. And this is just proving that one may expect distortions there, even if they were not distortions in single beta decays, because we have some more exotic model. Okay, so now this is true. This is the true conclusion. So I just wanted to say that about the complementarity of single and double beta decays, first a neutrinoless double beta decay from one side. And the other, I wanted to present these new direct searches at two neutrino double beta decays that could really help us in the light that there are no new future plans for any experiment searching the MeV mass regime. So that was all, thanks.
Okay, so thank you very much, Xavi. Questions? Ah, Enrique.
Hi.
Hey.
So, maybe you went through it, but I was busy at the same time, and maybe I missed it. So I obviously agree that it's quite natural to have a cancellation between the light neutrino and the heavy neutrino contribution.
Obviously.
But then you can also turn that argument in saying that the light neutrino contribution and the heavy neutrino contribution you naturally expect them to be of the same order in a CISO. So in the case of the simplest, the two neutrino CISO that you were discussing, how can you have the heavy neutrino contribution dominated?
The heavy neutrino.
Because you mentioned that this is a common assumption, which I agree it is. But if any contribution to neutrinoless orbital decay will also be a contribution of the same size to neutrino masses. So if it dominates in neutrinoless orbital decay, it means that it also dominates neutrino masses, more or less. You might have too large a contribution to neutrino mass.
So let me think. So there, the point is that two neutrino masses and this effective mass, the mixing pattern, so the powers of the U, do they enter in the same way always?
Well, it's as when you wrote the argument from our paper, essentially what you have is that these are the neutrino masses, right? This is where the neutrino mass is coming from. So what you have is that the sum over all, so of the heavy and the light, times the mixing squared is zero. So you can put all the light on one side and all the heavy on the other side. And then what you are seeing is that they are of the same order. Yes. They are exactly the same, actually, not of the same order. They are exactly the same in the simplest vanilla CISO.
Yep.
So if you stay at masses of the sterile below the scale of the neutrinoless process, below the hundreds of MeVs, then it should not dominate. It should be of the same order, actually, and it should tend to cancel each other.
Yeah, so that is what happens. So then I don't see. So I don't really see the problem there because that is what is happening, right? So this is the cancellation that you are having in the neutrinoless.
Yes, no, so maybe that's the thing that you always recover that cancellation. As I said, I might have missed it, but for instance, previously in the plots that you took from the paper from André de Gouvet and company, there it was assumed that the heavy neutrinos are dominating.
Yeah.
No, what I don't see is when can the heavy neutrinos actually dominate.
I totally agree with you. So to me, this typical line, I don't want to say that it is meaningless, but people abuse of it because they take it a lot. And as you were saying, these bounds, in many cases, they don't apply. So for type 1 CISO, basically, they won't apply.
Do you see a... Sorry, go on.
No, so they won't apply provided that they are all light or they are all heavy, as you know very well, I mean. And this is what we were getting also in this line, right? So you were getting something nice for neutrino-less when you were having that the fifth neutrino was actually heavier. So we were sticking one to be light, the other one to be heavy. But if both were light, basically you say nothing. So this is, if I remember correctly, the classification you had in your paper.
Yes.
And in the end, so...
And probably around this light is when I was distracted because I got an important email and hence my question. Sorry about that.
Sorry, didn't get it, but yeah, I totally agree with basically with the paper
okay,
you have with Matias.
So that's the thing, that you have one light and one hill.
So we were playing with that. So the we were assuming that you already had one at the key B because you have seen in Katrin, and then we were playing the game. Have you seen something at
okay, but then I have a follow-up question. If you have one light and one heavy, and you have mixings that are large enough for it to be relevant in neutrinos double beta decay, naively, I might be wrong, but naively, I expect that you need a cancellation between the contributions. So some sort of like it happens in the linear or the inverse, so that you have a cancellation between the different contributions, and then I would not expect to have one light and one heavy. I would expect to have a pseudo Dirac pair of almost degenerate heavy neutrinos.
Okay, let me think. So I could tell from these points in blue that we have here, they were able to reproduce neutrino masses and mixings. So in principle, there should be a way out. Now
there is a did you use the Casas Ibarra parametrization to do the scan?
Let me think about it, because this work was few years ago already.
Yeah.
I think not, but we were using an equivalent one.
I mean, because the thing is that there are papers of Jacobo López Pavón and Silvia Pascoli dealing with this. It's a subtle issue, which is the following. So if you consider, just adding two neutrinos as you are considering, like in the inverse ISO, and in the mass matrix, the Majorana mass matrix of those two neutrinos, the four entries that they have, right? In this view of a linear or an inverse ISO, you have the off-diagonal, which is like a Dirac mass, and it will tend to make it a Dirac pair. And you have the diagonal ones, which are Majorana, and therefore break lecton number. One of the two is the one that contributes to neutrino masses in an inverse ISO. Mm-hmm. The other does not contribute to neutrino masses at tree level. Mm-hmm. And therefore you can make large. And if you make large, indeed you can split, which I suspect is what you are seeing. You can split the pseudo Dirac pair to make one light and one heavy using this entry.
And then one loop things will explode.
Exactly. So you should test because they do not contribute to neutrino masses at tree level, but you will have a potentially sizable contribution at loop level that you should check. So depending on which parametrization you used, you might or not be taking into account the loop level effects.
Mm-hmm.
And it is something subtle that is easy to miss.
I know what you mean. I had to admit I don't remember the details we use to perform these plots. Because we were discussing several parametrizations, I remember reading some papers from Pilar, and because they were writing this situation where you have only two neutrinos in a detailed way. So in principle, we were not after the linear inverses in this case, but I don't know if indirectly we were taking
you
it
kind
without
of
realizing.
You kind of recover it in the sense that there is also this paper by Silvia in which they try to prove it as a theorem, which is not quite feasible. But for sure, for only two neutrinos, you can show that the only pattern that allows to have large mixings and small masses, and that is stable under radiative corrections, is that of a linear or inverse ISO. So it's an underlying lecton number symmetry, because there has to be a symmetry argument to protect you against radiative corrections. So even if you are not after an inverse or a linear pattern, you kind of are forced to it to protect neutrino masses.
Yeah, no, from radioactive things, you are totally right. I don't think we consider it. But I will need to check, to be honest, because it's kind of an old thing and I don't remember the details, sorry.
No, no problem. Thank you for the discussion and for the nice talk.
Okay, more questions?
Yes, may I?
Yes.
Hi, Xavi, how are you? Interesting work, this of comparing beta decay and double beta decay. So I find interesting. And I'm not an expert, but I have one curiosity that I would like to ask you. First, you have explained the issue of the kinks, finding kinks in single beta decay as to extract information on sterile mass and mixing. Good. Then you go to double beta decay and you try to see how the spectrum is distorted by the existence of one, two, etc. sterile neutrinos. I wonder why you don't have kinks, and I didn't really see the plot with timing off. What is the variable? Sorry, you are putting in the horizontal axis. Is the energy of what? In the so, yes, here. What is the variable in the horizontal axis?
So it's the sum of the kinetic energies of the two electrons.
I am asking you that because I wonder, maybe it's that plot. I wonder if you change the fact that you don't find kinks is because you have many particles in the final state, basically. So the fact the threshold, say, of the masses, which is what you are really trying to see in these kind of plots. In beta decay, in single beta decay, you find a kink because it's kinematics, it's less particles in the final states, I guess. Whereas in this case, you have more particles. And I wonder, probably is that variable, I don't know, what if you really studied invariant mass of the two electrons? Can you find sort of a kink or a more relevant distortion?
So
you understand my question?
Yeah, the problem.
Completely ignorant. Mm-hmm. Probably it makes no sense, the question.
Yeah, well, two things. So from one side, this is usually the value that is used experimentally. Because this kind of experiments, they basically have calorimeters. They don't have trackers or anything. So anything they can have access to is the energy.
They only can measure the energy. They don't measure the momentum, I guess.
There is only one experiment that is actually measuring not the full momenta, but they measure the energy and the angular separation between the two electrons.
That is important.
Only one experiment, and it's not clear whether the upgrade of that experiment that is keeping will continue doing that. Because if you are looking for neutrino less double beta decay, you don't care about angular. It's not that important. So you just basically focus in the energy sum, and this is the typical spectrum.
I didn't know that they didn't measure the momentum.
Yeah. And the reason why you don't have a kink, I think is precisely what you said. Because you have many particles, but the key is how many invisible particles you have.
Sure.
So here is basically the way the endpoint goes is smooth because you have two missing particles. It happens that if you have only one, so there are done processes that you have two electrons and one majoron that goes invisible. That one, it leads to kinks.
I see.
And it's something interesting because there are many experimental searches for that. No one has realized that.
It's interesting. So it's a fact of being, developing strategies in terms of the final variables of what you measure, which I don't know, which is what you measure, as to really sensitive to the appropriate variable where you see the kinks. That I'm sure there should be. I don't know which is the thing that you measure really, but probably studying in more detail the variables that they do measure in the experiment, you may reconstruct something which is like saying that you measure something which puts the two neutrinos together in one variable, energetic.
Yeah. So it depends because you have to notice that there are some experiments that they are close in the sense that, you know, basically the detector and the source are in the same place. So it's not like at the LHC that you have a clear point where the particles are coming and you can put all the system to measure the tracks, the energies and all the variables. Here it's like simpler in that sense, which makes a lot of sense to search for neutrinos, that's for sure. But
the proper variable would be the invariant mass of the two electrons, have explained to me that is not possible.
But still, still, the nice thing is that even if you don't have kinks, you can do things, because in the end you use the full spectrum. And also the kink thing is something that is very useful when you are dominated by systematics, because you can basically use some extra ingredient to remove your background or to improve your analysis. When you are dominated by the statistics, it's better just to take the full spectrum and that's it, because you will increase the amount of systematics. So that's a bit of a balance between the two. So having a kink, it's nice to see it because it's more spectacular, but it's not the crucial point for the analysis in the end.
Okay. Okay, thank you. I have many curiosities, but I can comment it to you privately.
Okay, sure.
It's all right. Thank you.
Okay, more questions? If not, we thank you again for your very nice talk, and goodbye.
Yeah, thanks a lot, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.